like to say good morning to everybody and thank Senator Kathy Marchione for joining us today. And then if everybody could introduce themselves.
My name is Joelle McClanlin. I work with the Community ICAM program, with the New York State ICAM program. I'm housed here in the Capital District. And I work a lot with school and turfgrass issues, but ticks have really taken over my life.
And Julie?
Oh, sure. Julie Suarez with the College of Agriculture and Life Sciences, Assistant Dean. So thanks for having us here. We really appreciate the connection.
Thank you.
My name is Matt Fry. I'm an extension educator with the New York State IPM program, and I am housed in Westchester.
And Matt, I have to tell you a huge thank you for the forum that you did with us at the Wallace Center. And because of that, I've made my husband, when we're working outside, remove his clothes, and I pulled ticks off of the both of us. It's been amazing every single time. So, thank you. Okay, would you like to start then?
Sure, so first, I guess we can advance the slide. Just wanted to say thank you for the opportunity to be here, and especially to Senator Serino, who has not only introduced bills to the Senate about education and prevention, which is in our opinion, the best way that we're going to address the tick problem, but also for securing funding for research and education. And a lot of that has gone to the Hudson Valley, where the tick problem is particularly bad, where I live and my family and friends are exposed. So this is very meaningful to me, and we really appreciate the Senator's efforts in this regard. So the reason we're here, obviously, is that ticks and tick-borne disease is a huge problem in New York State and in the Northeast. This map looks like a splatter of color, but what it represents is every dot is an incidence of disease related to tick infestations. And so in the Northeast, we have the worst cases of Lyme disease. 300,000 people each year are diagnosed with Lyme disease. And so this is a terrible infestation, a terrible problem that affects everybody, from children, from our parents that are out working in the yards, to school kids. So what I wanted to do today, real briefly, is walk you through what I think are five facts that will help you identify and manage ticks. So number one, tick identification is critical for management. I'm gonna have Joellen pass around this vial of ticks. There will be a quiz at the end, so I want everybody to take a close look at them. And we can go to the next slide.
Okay.
Identification of ticks is really important because if we identify a pest incorrectly, our management techniques are not going to be accurate. So I'm going to ask for some audience participation. Does anybody know what this critter is right here? If anybody travels, if anybody leaves their home, rides a bus, go to the movies, you want to know what this is because that is a bed bug.
Okay? Oh.
And it looks an awful lot like a tick, which may end up on your bed. If you have pets, if you're out and about and you lay on your bed, either of those can land on your resting location. And so identification is really important. And when you look at those samples, you may be confused to know that half of them are ticks. In our area, we have four tick species that can affect us. All of these are human biters. They suck our blood, okay? So it doesn't get any worse than that. We have the black-legged tick, the Lone Star tick, and the American dog tick. But looking at all those tick species isn't very helpful, and this slide is, okay? We want everybody to be able to identify the ticks that are pulled off of them. And this comes from a resource out of the University of Rhode Island, tickencounter.org, and really breaks down the identification. So when you look at those samples, if you're not too squeamish about it, you'll see that the black-legged ticks have this rounded portion and long mouth parts. And that's the tick, the only tick, that transmits Lyme disease. And so we really want to have our residents of New York State be able to identify that species. Black-legged tick is a blood-feeding ectoparasite, which means that it lives on the outside of our body. It is an ambush predator with a questing habit. So it doesn't chase you down when you're in the forest. It doesn't drop from trees to get you. It stands there with its little tarsi waiting for you to walk by and grabs you. Okay? So knowing that and knowing what tick species can bite us and transmit disease can reduce our exposure to them. This tick is found 1 to 1.5 feet off the ground and lower, and requires a high humidity. So that's number one, identification being very important. Number two, ticks are predictable. We know based on species where ticks are going to be found. So the Lone Star tick, which is originally a southern species making its way north, can be found in the woods, in the brush, and the lawn. Okay, pretty abundant, pretty difficult to avoid all of those situations. The black-legged tick, the one that transmits Lyme disease, is going to be found in the brush and in the lawn. And the American dog tick, which really doesn't bite humans all that often, that's the one that's commonly picked up in the bare sun areas. So how do we find ticks? If we know they're predictable, we know they're in certain habitats, now you all know that they're questing, they're waiting with their tarsi out for you. They want you to pick them up as you're walking through. Well, we can actually survey for ticks in specific areas to identify whether they're present or not. And Joellen has done a lot of work with this. We ask schools to do this so that they can determine whether or not ticks are present on their property before they take any control measures. Surveillance will tell us where they are and what treatment would be necessary. Deer are involved in the tick production process. I like to think of them as tick factories because each year, each deer can produce 500,000 ticks, okay? Each female that feeds on them is going to reproduce as an adult and create larval ticks. So the white-tailed deer are a problem. They're host for about 90% of ticks, and they are the long-distance dispersers of ticks. Deer can go far distances and carry those ticks with them. If you can see this picture clearly, you can see that there's probably hundreds of ticks attached to its ear. The problem with deer is that we have a lot of them, and 6 to 8 deer per square mile is the ideal density for them. But often we have more than 40 per square mile. And so they're part of the process, they're part of the tick production process, but the real critter is next. The white-footed mouse. So in terms of ticks getting infected with disease, these are the most critical organisms because the mice harbor the bacteria associated with Lyme disease and other pathogens. And when a tick feeds on that mouse, it can then transmit those bacteria and other pathogens to humans. So they're what's considered the amplifying host because they're the ones that hold the disease and then it's transmitted through the ticks. Here's the lovely life cycle of ticks. In case you haven't seen enough with those samples, now you can see them up close. They're definitely disgusting. When the female feeds to repletion, when she's full with blood, that's when she lays her eggs. In the first year, those eggs will hatch and be nymphs. Now, those nymphs are not infected with any pathogens. There's no transmission from mom to offspring. But when they feed and become nymphs in the next year, the larvae molt to nymphs, that's the infective stage. So in most of New York, and in other parts of the country, the spring is the time when most people get Lyme disease because the nymphal ticks are smaller, harder to detect. They're out when we're not really checking ourselves for ticks, and they're the ones that are transmitting the bacteria, especially Lyme disease. The adults are much larger and easier to see, so people often will identify them on their bodies and not be exposed. So just to represent that life cycle again, these are our cartoon drawings of those small mammals like mice. Chipmunks also are important reservoirs of disease. Larvae hatch and are not infected, but feed on something that's infected, and all subsequent stages are infected with that bacteria, and then can affect other hosts such as deer and ourselves. But deer are not important in the transmission of disease. What's also predictable about tick populations is based on some work done in the Carey Institute, where we know that the production of acorns in one year, such as last year, we had a huge bumper crop of acorns. In the subsequent year, we have a huge bumper crop of small mammals. So this year, if you have acorn trees, maybe you've seen hundreds and hundreds of chipmunks running around. also white-footed mice, then next year we can predict that there's going to be a high incidence of ticks and a high incidence of Lyme disease. So we do have some predictive abilities when it comes to tick populations. Number three, remove ticks with tweezers. Please. Okay, ticks are attracted to us. We breathe carbon dioxide, we have heat coming off our bodies, and we produce other smells that are really attractive to them. When they get on us, they walk around, make sure they can find the right spot, and then they insert their mouth parts into us and cement their mouth parts into our bodies. The saliva that they inject prevents pain, clotting, and an immune reaction, so we may not know that we have a tick on our body. Here's a close-up of those really nasty mouth parts that actually have serrated edges and cut their way into our skin. May take up to 2 hours for them to do that, and they can stay attached to the host for at least 4 days. During this time is when they're injecting their saliva and the pathogens that cause disease. Some reports indicate that in less than 6 hours, a tick can transmit Lyme disease. For other pathogens, it may be even less. And so here's the clincher. I actually brought a set of fine-tip tweezers to show you how to remove a tick, because using anything else, using a turnkey, using burning, suffocation with Vaseline, or squeezing them, can all result in the tick regurgitating more of its gut contents into you. And so your chance of getting a pathogen increases with those tick removal practices. So how to remove a tick, this is from the CDC, if you need to reference that for people. Fine tip tweezers as close to the mouth as possible and pull them out. Number four, an ounce of prevention. So there's a number of steps that we can take when we go out that can help us reduce our exposure to ticks. There are steps before, during, and after. Before, we can treat our clothing. There are insecticide products that bind to the material that will not affect our person, our skin, that will keep the ticks off of our clothing. Once the tick starts walking on this, it gets a lethal dose of insecticide and dies. We can create a clean zone, and this is what the senator was talking about beforehand. If we are out and we're exposed to ticks, we can take off that clothing before we go inside, put it in a plastic bag, and then not worry about bringing ticks inside with us. We want to wear light-colored clothing, shirts tucked in the pants. I'm sure all this information has been distributed before. You've probably seen these recommendations in the past. It does make for a nice fashion statement. Some personal protection we can recommend to the residents of New York State, different types of products to repel ticks, and also those permethrin treatments that will kill ticks on contact. There's actually been research, and I don't know if anybody in this room would volunteer to have ticks inoculated on their bodies, but the researchers treated shorts and a t-shirt and found that when they put ticks on the person, that there were fewer that survived if clothing was treated. And so it's another great recommendation. If possible, stay on the path. Now you all know they're just waiting for you to come by. So if you stay on that trail, your incidence of picking up a tick is reduced. Regular tick checks in the field. I'm an entomologist and I love insects, and so I always have a vial. And I can show you what they look like, but a simple pill jar will do. If your residents in your district are concerned about ticks and they want to go outside, just a simple tick check, drop them in alcohol, tick is killed. We can put our clothing through the dryer to kill any insects that are on our clothing. This is also a technique that's used for bed bugs, but it's very efficient at killing ticks on our clothing. Tick checks, as we said, whole body, daily and regularly, just in case you've missed one. And if you think that you don't have time for a tick check, think again. All of us have to do this. And so University of Rhode Island thinks that this is a great time for a tick check, as is taking a shower. Our pets also need to be protected. There's a number of liquid, oral, and collar treatments now that are very effective at killing ticks, and grooming after possible exposure will remove those ticks. eliminate tick habitat. Again, this is something that's probably a little bit more challenging, but once we know where the ticks are harboring or where the host of ticks, in mammal terms, that is a rodent hotel. When you look at those rock walls, there could be hundreds of mice living in there, and that's the host to the tick. We can create tick zones so that our children are safe on a swing set and not exposed to ticks that may be in the woods. And of course, as probably a last result, when tick infestations are really bad and we know that they're constantly being picked up by people, we can do acaricide applications, which are direct applications to leaf litter and other areas that are moist that will kill the ticks on contact. Number 5, research is key for answers about ticks, tick-borne disease, and management. So there's a new study being conducted in the Hudson Valley by Dr. Rick Osfeld of the Cary Institute, where he is evaluating the use of the tick control system on a large scale. Entire neighborhoods are getting this tick treatment system along with a treatment of a bacteria that's sprayed on the soil. And he's looking at how this area-wide treatment will affect tick populations. And this research is critical because previous research has shown that individual yards that are treated may not result in reduced incidence of disease. So we need to have this large-scale project to understand the dynamics of ticks and their hosts. There's some research recently on Lyme vaccines where we'll actually treat mice to be resistant to Lyme disease. This research, again, has shown that if we treat the host that normally reservoirs the disease, we can prevent the ticks from inoculating us with those pathogens. Joellen is involved in a mulch mowing study. One of the recommendations in Westchester is to mulch leaves directly into the lawn so that we're not incurring costs of removing leaves from property. And we're also making the environment more nutrient efficient. But it's possible that this increases the moisture content of the soil and will lead to higher tick populations. And this year we'll be looking at Christmas tree farms because there's some suspicion that ticks may be in the area of Christmas trees, and we want to make sure that people aren't bringing them home when they go for their Christmas tree. Now I have some tick trivia for everyone that's been paying attention. Okay, so do deer play a vital role in Lyme disease transmission? I see one head nod. What do you guys think? They do not. He was correct. So deer are the reproductive host of the ticks.
Good question.
What's that?
That's a trick question.
There's a lot of trick questions, so put your thinking cap on. Next question. Mice are the primary reservoir of Lyme disease. Yes, all right. At least you're not afraid to answer questions. That often happens. Next question. All stages of ticks can transmit Lyme disease. Again, he's correct. No, they cannot. The nymphs and adults transmit Lyme, but that first stage, the larvae that emerge from the egg, do not transmit Lyme disease. Ticks must be attached for 24 to 48 hours to transmit Lyme. No, a resounding no. New evidence suggests that less than 16 hours is needed. And last but not least, ticks are not active in the wintertime. I did not talk about it. So it's not a trick question, I just didn't give you the information. Actually, ticks are active at any time the temperature is above 40. So if you went hiking this winter, when we had temperatures in the 40s, 50s, 60s, even in January, ticks can be active. So it's always important to do those tick checks when you're out in the environment. And with that, thank you for your attention. Don't want to go too much into the details, but if there's any questions about ticks or tick management, we're happy to answer those. Thank you. Any questions?
And Matt, I'd like to make a comment. When we did our forum in Hyde Park during the summer, there were some picnics that we do for seniors. Two individual seniors had come up to me and told me that they had been diagnosed with dementia but since coming to the forum, pushed their doctors, and they actually had Lyme disease.
Wow.
So, yeah.
Yeah, the long-term effects of Lyme are still being studied.
Yes.
So finding those ticks right away is really important to prevent, you know, late-stage arthritis and all kinds of other problems.
And I love the presentation that you do because it's simple. You know, just like when we sent the brochures to the schools, they asked us for thousands more. Mm. So it was great. You know, and kids are very visual too, so that's why they like those little vials. I guess I'm a big kid because I like those vials too. But it really helps show, you know, that it really is like the size of a poppy, like you said, the poppy seed.
Right.
So now the kids are a little bit more, you know, paying attention, I think, when we bring these around. So.
That's
very
good.
Education. Education, you know, education is key, and we talk about that all the time. And I also want to thank Stephen and Alexandra Cohen Foundation because of the state being able to get the money to have research. They contributed $5 million to the Carey Institute, so that's great. And Dr. Rick Osfeld, it's wonderful. For all of you, with all your hard work that you do, thank you.
You're quite welcome. I like this slide because it shows a lot of the resources that we have.
Mm-hmm.
If you're ever looking for materials for your own newsletters, we cover ticks quite often in a blog that we do. And in fact, we recently did one specifically talking about tick removal.
Okay.
So that's a resource that you can kind of grab and highlight for people.
And I've actually had people tell me that, oh, you can take a cotton swab with oil and put it on the tick and it'll back out. And it'll back out, but like you said, Matt, it actually puts the
dispenses.
Yes.
Make it regurgitate.
Yes.
Yes.
So.
Misinformation abounds on the internet, so
careful
of our resources.
You saw it on the internet, so we have to set the record straight.
Yes, absolutely.
Well, this is a step in the right direction to do that. So thank you. I don't know if does anybody else have questions. Well, thank you very much for doing the presentation today, and I know we have a forum coming up at the end of June, and I look forward to doing that as well. Thank you.
Thank you.